the podcast Nowhere Near Hollywood. It's Afternoon Coffee with Mike and Tim.
Hey, that was good. What I was thinking was maybe welcome to the Afternoon Coffee podcast with Mike and Tim.
Nice try, boys, but this is how it should sound. This is the Afternoon Coffee podcast with Mike and Tim.
Okay, thanks, Heather. And this is Afternoon Coffee. I'm Mike.
And I am Tim.
All right. And today we do have a special guest. We have a guy that I follow on social media. He's I think, on every branch of social media I'm involved in. He's got a lot of really good content out there. He's one of those people that he doesn't put out any kind of fluff. Most everything he has a lot of meat to it, and that's why I really enjoy seeing his stuff. But anyway, he's a husband, a father, a former radio guy, which, of course, those of us who used to be in radio know that that means you're not just a radio personality. You normally have wear many hats when you work in radio. He was a former production and creative services director at CBS Radio. He was also a new car salesman on a couple of different occasions. One was Mercedes. Oh, very nice. You must have been good. He's a voiceover artist, a podcaster, a podcast producer, an entrepreneur. Very good resume, Jim.
Yeah, you know, I'm very impressed with this person that you're describing. I have no idea who it is.
Sounds like he's done quite a bit.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, we are talking to Jim McCarthy today. He's got a lot of experience in a lot of different areas, and we're just glad to have him. It's quite a journey you've been on.
Thank you. Well, you know, you just make the decisions the best you can when you have the opportunity to make them, I guess. So, well, I appreciate that.
Yeah.
How are you guys doing?
Good. Tim Miller here. Say, Jim, so I see we may have something in common here. I'm originally from Canton, Ohio, and you're from Connecticut, born and raised, correct?
Yes, sir.
Awesome.
Yes, sir.
Then, tell me more about Connecticut.
That's not much really the report.
And the report is nothing.
They are, Connecticut was our home for, 23, 24 years. Met my wife there. We got married there. Got into radio there. Learned a lot of different trades, like the electrical trade, while I was living there. Of course, made a lot of mistakes there. had the opportunity to move to Vegas in 2001, so we did. And it was one of those things that, you know, the big adventure, right? The trepidatious, you know, what if type of scenario of moving 2,000 miles away from where you grew up actually turns out fairly well, and everything generally is okay. And we were there for 4 years, and we had perspective. We looked back on moving back to the quote East Coast, but definitely not Connecticut, because we knew we didn't want to be there anymore. And we ended up in Nashville in 2005. And we've been here ever since. So just kind of pursuing the radio dream, and then got out of it. The dream, 2013.
So the radio dream ended in 2013. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. That was over then. Yeah. Tell us about that.
It was done. Well, a lot of, you know, radio for me was a huge part of my adult life. It was huge in terms of my identity, and I was very good at it. But after a time, you just kind of hit that ceiling of not much more to be made in the industry unless you really started becoming somebody well-known in the major markets and you were on air, became a major personality. And the chances of that happening and the industry staying on the trajectory it was going in terms of, you know, you couldn't make the ability to make a really good living in a major market was becoming less and less. So I saw the kind of the writing on the wall, and, you know, given the past 7 years and seeing what the industry has done, it's kind of, you know, validated my decision. So I'm like, hey, I've always had an opportunity or a proclivity to want to sell cars, of all things. So one of my clients that I had through the radio station in Nashville, I've been working with them for many, many years with the radio station and outside of the radio station, doing various types of content creation. Local Honda dealer, great guy who ran the place at the time. He always said that if you ever want to try selling cars, come on over. Okay, yeah. That was easy enough. And that's what I did. Actually, I had a little bit of a brief stint in the collision business in between the gear shifts, or not the gear shifts, the career shifts. And, you know, that lasted all of 2 months. One of my, if you look back at some of the stuff I put out, I talk about the different failures that I've had throughout my life. And that might have been one of them. But again, looking back on it, it's certainly one of the things that I reflect on that is shaped me. So it's all these different things have happened for a reason. So got into the car business, got out of radio, completely fish out of water. Thought I was a pretty fairly good salesman. That was quickly disproven once I got into the car business. I was good at starting and gaining rapport and presenting the product in a decent way. But when it actually came down to the nuts and bolts and saying, okay, what are we doing here? Are you going to buy this thing or what? You know, that kind of the closing aspect of it. When you got to get assertive with somebody, it gets very uncomfortable, and you got to find your voice, and you got to find your own way within the fundamentals to achieve that goal. So
true.
Huge learning experience for me. And about after 3 or 4 months of doing it, of me, you know, basically wondering what the heck I was doing with my life and deciding to finally sink my teeth into it and commit, I figured it out and spent about 3 years in that business.
Interesting. 3 years. Sold a lot of cars in that time, I'm sure. That's good. Yeah.
You know, I think we've all run across these car salesmen that aren't good at that closing. You know, it's sort of like, you know, they kind of hit you right between the eyes. And it's like, and nobody likes that, you know. So, yeah, I get what you're saying.
You've had a recent experience, Mike.
Yeah, I just bought a truck on Friday. What day is today?
Monday. Oh, really?
Yeah, I bought a truck on Friday, yeah. And I walked in. I had done all my research and everything, and I think that, I don't know whether it was your podcast or somebody else's. It's like, you know, when they walk in, you kind of assume that they've done their research. It might have been somebody else. But, you know, so I walked in, and I had my fistful of research, you know, and most of it was in my head, but I had some with me. And I knew the price that I was going to, that was my lowest price or the highest price I was going. And I walked in, and he slapped me in the face with $2,000 less than my highest price I was going to. I'm like going, well, man, he made it easy for me. And of course, my wife kind of hit me. She goes, you probably could have got $1,000 off of that. I said, well, probably, but I was on my heels. It was great. And just a friendly guy, it made it very, very easy. So,
yeah, it doesn't have to be a pain in the butt. You know, it really doesn't. What did you end up buying?
Oh, it's a 2020 Toyota Tacoma. It's my third Tacoma. I've had, my son just inherited my 2008, which he had. Now we're selling his also inherited 2004 Tacoma that I had. So yeah, every time that this is my tow tag truck. I think I talked to you the other day. It's like, this is my tow tag house, my tow tag truck. Mm. This is it. My, you know, until they take the keys away from me and said, Mr. Tarno, you're not allowed to drive anymore. And that's it. So
you never know, man. You never know.
So I
hope that's not the case.
You never know.
So, Jim, I recently went into my Mazda dealer. I bought a 2017 Miata RF. Love the car. But I bring it in there for the oil changes. And anyway, I guess my personality, I'm outgoing, and I was talking to the lady up front, and I guess she has some authority there, and she may be part owner. I don't know. But anyway, she said, you know what? She said, you would really work out great as a salesman here. And I thought about that. And the reason I didn't do it is because I'd done three oil changes before that, and I tried each time to do their radio broadcast or their commercials. And anyway, I was not successful at it. But I thought, if I can't be successful at doing their commercial, how in the world can I sell a car? So anyway, so
in terms of closing them on doing the work for them, you mean?
Yeah, for a voiceover for their radio commercial. I thought, if I can't sell myself, in other words, if they won't buy into, she's, oh yeah, you got a great voice, you know, and so if I couldn't do that, then I'm thinking, what makes me think I could sell a car to anybody? So I'm not working here.
Well, I was going to say, have you tried, did you do like a spec for them and say, hey, here's how I can sound?
No, because she said she liked my voice. So I may do them a spec and try that.
Right.
I was going to go back
that
to the radio.
That would be my next suggestion.
I may try that. Yeah, thanks, man. Because that's a good marketing thing as well. And I've done that in the past, but not for this group. My question about radio is, when recently there's a station here in Chattanooga that, you know, is hiring, but it's like 5 a.m. to 12:30 in the afternoon. But if you read the fine print, it says in all marketing events, you know, in promos and all that. So tell me about that. You're a family guy. How much, there is no set time really, because you tell me about that, because are there times after your work hours that they demand you to be there?
In my experience, you know, like for a morning show, they would typically get there around 3:30, 4 o'clock in the morning, generally do their show prep, start the show around 5 or 5:30, go on the air, and do a show until about 10 o'clock, maybe even earlier than that. I don't know. And they would have, sometimes have to stay afterwards for maybe a sales meeting or something, but generally, you know, it's about an 8 or 9 hour day for them. So they were out the door by about 11 o'clock. So, and then they had the rest of the day to themselves, because, you know, typically in that situation, that's how I always saw it play out. In my situation, I wasn't really on the air all that much. I was typically, you know, 8:30 to 5:30. So
okay.
The hours were pretty standard. Yeah.
Yeah. I thought you had to do events or things like that.
Not me. I wasn't a personality. I was a personality in Connecticut. So if they required, you know, if you wanted to do an event, it was extra money for you because you got talent fee. Now, whether that's still a part of the equation these days, I'm not sure. I wouldn't be a bit surprised if they removed that as well. So, you know, with iHeartMedia basically removing 1,200 jobs from the their bottom line is recently.
Is that right?
Yeah, that happened a couple of weeks ago. It was awful. A lot of people lost their jobs, you know? And I think, and I think you touched on this on your podcast. It's probably going to be a big influx into, let's say, the voiceover industry or whatever. Yeah, from those people, they're going to need to pay their bills somehow.
Well, yeah, and it's there was a guy who I had on my podcast who hit the nail on the head. He talked about a lot of the radio talent saying, "Hey, look, I feel for you, but this is kind of your fault. You should have seen this coming." Working for the company that you worked for is akin to, you know, being a contractor on the Death Star. Okay. You shouldn't be surprised, you know, when this happened. This company is known for doing mass layoffs like this. And they kind of set a precedent with doing what they did, because now all the other companies are saying, well, if they can do it, why don't we do it? And, you know, all this production, this programming, the on-air talent should be shaken in their boots. And basically laying the foundations for their next phase of their career, which I believe exists within the world and paradigm of personal branding. You know, if you can make yourself into a personality using radio as your springboard and as your main platform of which to drive all your other platforms, let's say an Instagram profile, Facebook, LinkedIn, what have you, TikTok, and you start, you know, bringing all those listeners over to those platforms, then you don't have to worry about being fired from a radio gig, because you probably have figured out how to monetize the other channels. This way, if a radio station wants to like let you go, you can go into the office and say, "Are you sure about this? Because I'm basically going to plant my flag somewhere else, and everyone's going to come with me." So, okay. Good luck with that strategy.
How do you see the voice tracking industry? Is that going to be taken over mostly, or do you see that kind of going away too and just be automated type stuff?
Well, they've been doing the voice tracking, man, since I was in radio. I did a partial live and 2-hour voice tracked show at night. So I was doing 6 to midnight. So I was there actually in the studio from 6 to 10, and I had 2 hours of the shift voice tracked. So, you know, oddly enough, I'd be driving home and still hear myself. For the people that are listening that are laymen, voice tracking is basically like virtual DJing, where, I mean, literally in Nashville, our afternoon guy on one of the radio stations is voiced by a guy in Asheville, North Carolina, of all places. So very interesting kind of shakeup that went down with that. It's like, you know, to me, it's like, okay, a guy in Asheville doing the afternoon, that doesn't make sense. You should actually have someone in Nashville doing all, but, you know, I digress. Is it going to
You're right.
I don't know if it's going to go away, you know? I don't know if it's going to go away. I think it's becoming more prevalent because they don't have the talent there anymore. So they're diversifying and spreading their talent way too thin.
Well, I think with the way iHeartRadio, that whole debacle was, it's like in every radio station, Cumulus, I don't think it's just them, but I think when you look at, you know, you can go to a voice track and not have to pay insurance. You don't have to pay, you know, any kind of benefits whatsoever. You're paying them a set rate to kind of plug in their tracks into their computer, and that's it. And it doesn't matter where in the world they are, when they recorded. And it just seems like it's easier for them. Of course, the talent doesn't get what they used to get back 30, 40 years ago. But, you know, it seems like a win-win for the radio stations.
It is. It makes good business sense. And I believe that, you know, this is one thing that the car business kind of taught me, was that everybody, I think, needs some sort of fundamental selling experience. Because I don't believe that, you know, the reason why agents exist, both in voiceover and in talent acquisition and development, for like, you know, commercial talent or TV talent, radio talent, that kind of thing. The reason why they exist is because of talent, they don't know how to sell themselves. So the agent does the selling for them and they take a piece. So if they're able to learn how to sell themselves, and in those situations, say, okay, let me understand this situation right now. Instead of reacting emotionally and saying, how dare you, you greedy SOBs, take all this, you know, talent off the table. They're not seeing it from the business owner's standpoint. Obviously, the business owner or the manager, the operator, has a pain. They have a problem. That is, the radio industry has been consolidated. There is, the listenership is being fractured. It's getting increasingly tougher to sell because of fractured listenership, people having other options like digital, Spotify, Pandora,
exactly,
podcasting, yeah, things of that nature. So the pain is getting greater for these radio station operators. So naturally, they're trying to figure out, okay, how can we adapt? We haven't done a good job of adapting over the years with keeping up with the trends. And, you know, a lot of them, you know, when I would talk to them in the past, even the most recent years, why aren't you making podcasts out of these radio shows? Their immediate response is, well, how do we monetize that? Our main monetization avenue is on-air commercials, or on-air commercials. They tried doing that with digital offerings such as SEO and websites and things like that within my group, even when I worked for radio. But it didn't really pan out because it's like McDonald's selling lobster. You know, it didn't really make much sense. Okay,
yeah. You
guys do radio. What do you know about what's this website thing? What do you know about building websites? How does that make sense? So they tried kind of all things in the platform and execution. So they've got this great pain. They've got to figure it out. They got to, you know, the next step is to cut costs. So that's what they're doing now, is cutting costs. So as a talent, getting back to my original point, coming to the table and saying, hey, we're going to go ahead and just let you go. Well, tell me why is this, you know, what is the pain? How can I achieve and help you guys solve that problem? Selling is no more than just identifying a problem to solve, identifying the pain and making it better. And if you can do that, that's how money gets transferred, you know?
Yeah. But you talked about that being other centric, I think is the word you use for when you're going to sell. Them centric. That's what it is. So it's like when you're looking at selling yourself, saying you're a voice talent or you're a radio guy or whatever you're doing, I mean, yeah, you see that there's a need to be filled, and you figure out a way to let them know that you can fill it. Yeah,
that's right. And it's you know, you, Mike, you know this. If you're in my Facebook group, the Blue Collar Voiceover Association, and you have a lot of the voiceover talent out there, similar to the, you know, the jocks that are being let go or being marginalized, there are elite voiceover talent that have been used to getting these high rates, and, you know, deservedly so.
Sure.
It's not that I'm taking that away from them, but due to the massive influx of talent in the voiceover industry, it's supply and demand. You know, you got a lot of supply. You're basically being commoditized at this point. They don't like that. So when you have these new people coming on board that are willing to do work for, you know, $5 a holler or $10, whatever, $50, they accuse them of driving the industry to the bottom. It's a race to the bottom.
Yeah.
So you're seeing that kind of phenomenon happen in the voiceover industry too, where, guys, this is no longer about you getting on a pay-to-play site or getting an agent. This is about working with the client directly. Like what you were talking about before, going to the car dealership, how can I present a potential problem that you have, or a solution to something that you weren't even aware of? I can be your voice, and I can be available directly to you on a 24-hour turnaround basis. Let's say you have, you know, a special that comes down the night before and you want to get it out there. Maybe the radio station talent doesn't have that kind of turnaround time. Maybe they're not that good, because that's the benefit you bring to the table is being a professional, a pro guy, and being a market exclusive, unique voice to their group of dealerships. So I'm presenting all these different value propositions to you that you could run with and say, what's it going to take for me to be the voice of your group of dealerships? And whenever you need something, you just let me know. We turn it around, put me on retainer. Oh man,
that's good.
How do we
Real
go
good,
about doing
yeah.
it? You know, it's all about them. It's not about you.
And one thing I heard recently is that if you do approach like a car dealership or whatever, you can say that if, you know, you end up going with me, I will throw in all your IVR, your phone prompts, you know, that'll be, I'll be your voice in every aspect on your website or whatever. But the phone thing, that'll be all on the house if you go with me.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's not a bad idea.
However you want to do it. And, you know, starting out with one thing like, you know, adding that as an added value, or just saying, you know, if that's basically, hey, do you want fries with that kind of proposition?
Yeah. Supersize me. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you guys thought about, you know, you could even go in that way. Hey, you had me on hold before. I noticed that you played that, you know, generic music, or you played that generic music, or you played, you know, something that just didn't, you know, some, maybe receptionist recorded it, and it just kind of very, you know, it doesn't sound professional. That's an in.
Yeah.
Have you guys thought about doing this? You know, it's them centric. It's not about you. I always say it's, if you make it more about them over and over and over again, over time, it will become more about you, because people will start accrediting you with that information and content.
And I'm sure this spills over in every business.
I have a shift in the conversation. My shift is, Jim, have you found in the past, and you're so gracious to be on our podcast, and we humbly appreciate that, but have you found in the past that some voiceover talents don't want to help other voiceover talents? And why is that so?
I think there's a definite, I'm trying to think of the word. Sorry, it's early. And we're camping in Chattanooga of all places. I'm getting to work.
I'm in Ringgold. I live down the street from probably where you're at.
We're at Raccoon Mountain.
Oh yeah. That's down the road, man. Yeah.
Oh, right on. There's definitely some, like kind of a pain in the butt when it comes to newbies that are, you know, reaching out to certain voice talent who, and I can see where they're coming from when they're getting tired of being asked the same question. Hey, how do I get into this? And, cause you know, the noobs are coming to the experienced folk with very them centric questions. This is all about me. This is not about me helping you, the one with the experience. Uh-huh. It's, hey, how do I get into this? It's very, you know, me-centric, and that could be wearing over time, and I kind of understand that. But at the same time, it's a whole new market of opportunity coming up for that particular voiceover talent to be maybe a mentor or a coach or someone who can do some training and make some money that way. So with everybody who comes to me and asks, so how do I, you know, I was told all the time that I have a good voice. Now, how many times have we heard that? Mm-hmm. Well, you can have the greatest voice in the world. If you don't know how to use it, that's where you kind of you falter. And the second part of the question was what?
I think that was the entire question is, why don't people in the voiceover industry that are experienced, why don't they, and sometimes they won't even communicate. They won't even answer an email. I mean, they won't even do that. I mean, even go that far, yet they'll have their face and their voice plastered all over Facebook and LinkedIn, and they're over the top people. I'm not going to name any names, but Mike and I have discussed it before, but these are people that, and you probably know, Jim, some of these folks that I'm talking about, but they're just way over the top and out there, a personalities. And it almost gets tiring for the guy that is not that personality. You more than likely are behind the microphone, but you're not that personality way out there like these people with, you know, the muscle shots or the, it's wearing and taxing on you to see that they are so outgoing. And I know they're trying to sell, it's them centric, like you said, but it just gets, it gets old, man. It just does. And they don't want to genuinely even return your emails or help, you know, in any way.
Yeah. There are some people that are just like that, you know, and, there's a similar thing that happens in Nashville. My pal, I do a podcast with him. His name is Rich Redmond. He plays with Jason Aldean, and he's a drummer in Nashville. He has been for 23 years. But before, you know, the whole Jason Aldean thing happened, he had to kind of play the talent lottery, the artist lottery. So he played with anybody he could. He would play, you know, he would kick jokes for comedians, magicians. He would do weddings. You know, samba band, you know, he was very, very well versed in styles, so he could work. He could really adapt and be a chameleon. But, you know, his goal was to get the big gig when he came here. So he sat down, had a lot of coffee with a lot of different people, showed up and networked with people, mingled, handed out his demos. In a way, being that person that you're describing, that's kind of like, you know, the A-type personality and very, you know, pushing their message out into the marketplace, spreading their seed, if you will. But the only thing different about him is that now he's getting hit up constantly from people in, you know, Billings, Montana, who want to make a go of it in Nashville. Hey, when I get to town, can I take you out to coffee? He'll tell you, he's like, dude, I drink a lot of coffee. And yeah. I usually end up paying for it. But he goes, but he will, if he has the time, he will sit down with somebody and genuinely, generously give you his time to talk to you and tell you how to go about it. I told him, I said, there's a revenue stream for you there. But it's worked out for him because when in the beginning he knew who everybody else was, now it's that coin has turned. It's everybody knows who he is. So
that's good.
He's one of the most in-demand drummers in town now. And he's getting into acting, and he's going to make a go of it in acting in Hollywood, just using that same kind of process. He's always about just taking the higher road, being the nice guy. It could be wearing after a while, but if this is what you want, you kind of have to give it back. If you work that hard to get all the information, it's kind of incumbent upon you to hand it down. If you watch any of the stuff that we produce on his podcast, it's called The Rich Redmond Show. He has a lot of his drum heroes that have helped him in the beginning. A lot of guys that were in the 80s and 90s that you walk into a grocery store, and if they're playing a country radio station, the chances of hearing them playing on it are very good. These guys were like one of a fraternity of five guys that played on everything back in the day. Wow. They are sweethearts, these guys. They're just so humble. Mm. So like
attracts
like
that.
In that
sense. Have you seen the Garth Brooks special that he put out probably a month or two ago now, where it was like a 2-3 part series where he talked about everything, his journey from Oklahoma going to Nashville, having to go back to Oklahoma and back, very similar kind of story. You know, he didn't know anybody and he was very, very big, rejected big time. But he's one of the nice guys in country also. Same kind of story.
The thing about Garth and what I've heard, I've never had the pleasure of meeting him, but he can meet you, like if you met him 3 years ago and you meet him again, you know, after a certain amount of time or after 3 years, I guess, he will remember your name. Now that is a talent.
Yeah, that's good.
I'm happy if I can do it after 3 minutes.
I know. Wow. I had a trick in the car business to help me remember my customers' names, but man, there were times where I'd be sitting on a test drive going, all right, what were their names?
Yeah, that's funny.
That wraps up part one of our interview with Jim McCarthy. Come back next week, and we will have part two for you. And as Red used to say, good night, and may God bless.
Guests on the Afternoon Coffee podcast stay at the Real Rest Inns and Suites, the only 2-star hotel in the tri-state area with a don't ask, don't tell policy for snakes and other exotic pets.
This episode has been made possible by our awesome intro voice, Heather Foster. You can find out more about her at heatherfostervoice.com.
All music has been provided and produced by Marble Planet Productions. You can hear more about them on Instagram at Marble Planet Productions. If you'd like to get in contact with us, you can either email us at afternooncoffeepodcast@gmail.com or tweet us at afternoonjava.